Kamala Persad-Bissessar, Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and His Excellency Wuna Mog, Union Minister of Foreign Affairs of Myanmar. I now give the floor to Her Excellency Kamala Persad-Bissessar, Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Mr. President, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, all. May I say good morning to you? Well, I can't hear you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Great. It's a great morning because we're all here together, and I thank you for joining us. At the outset, let me extend my support for the statement delivered by the President of Guyana, His Excellency Donald Ramata, on behalf of the Caribbean Community, CARICOM. I also wish to compliment you, as well as the Secretary General, for convening this conference less than 1 year after the adoption of Resolution 65313. We meet today at a time when the prospects for global economic recovery are increasingly overshadowed by many downside risks. In the face of these risks, the United Nations must not, in my respectful view, abdicate its responsibility to forge common positions and devise ways geared to improving the global economic and financial situation, which has impacted very negatively on development and resulted in dire social consequences for all the people of our lands. If we are successful in our endeavors, we may avoid a second major crisis. There's also a real risk that the present global fragility could impact on small peripheral economies and other developing countries that were able to withstand the initial impact of the crisis due to strong domestic economic buffers. However, it is likely that these countries may not be able to withstand a second shock of similar magnitude, having not as yet attained pre-crisis economic strength. The global outlook is not very promising. The IMF projects that global economic growth will decrease from about 4% in 2011 to about 3.5% in 2012 because of weak activity during the second half of 2011 and first half this year, 2012. This unflattering picture makes it imperative that we embrace new approaches to development to replace those which have created underdevelopment and persistent poverty in very many countries. Homegrown solutions must, in my respectful view, assume major importance if we are to achieve long-term successes. In the Caribbean, we are shifting the old paradigm of development dependent on external sources to a new one of Caribbean convergence. Endogenous growth must be the real driver of Caribbean development. We are beginning to witness, however modest, some success as a result of this new approach to development. The Caribbean is projected to grow by approximately 3% in 2012, after expanding by an average of 1.7% during the first half of 2011. In the case of my own country, Trinidad and Tobago, my government remains steadfast in its mission to address lingering financial vulnerabilities and to refocus our efforts on promoting growth and diversification. These policies have had some positive effects, and the IMF has noted that economic recovery in 2012 came after an extended slowdown lasting about 3 years. Mr. President, Mr. Chair, the inclusion of the international financial institutions in this conference is commendable. We now have an opportunity as states to engage in open and frank discourse with these Washington-based institutions and to impress upon them the need for small states such as that of Trinidad and Tobago and others in the CARICOM to have a greater voice in the operations. And so I submit respectfully today that this will lead to greater transparency and an increase in the credibility of these bodies. The economic recession impacted on many European capitals, and the current crisis within the Eurozone rivers around the world. In the Greek capital, large sections of population are calling for a shift in the economic model of strict austerity as a means to economic growth. Economic models have to treat with the social and political climate of today. It is clear that there is a need for more discussion on the different parts to economic growth, and it should not be treated as a mantra. We need to think outside the box. We in the developing countries are asked to slavishly follow the economic policy dictated in the North without due regard for our very particular economic and social circumstances. It is now time that we are all allowed greater participation at the table with our views, ideas, and special experiences. We have to forge a new economic paradigm which adequately caters for our interests only and also. It cannot be business as usual. The topics for discussion by the roundtables are constructive and form a useful platform upon which we can build our deliberations. And please offer me a moment to make a few suggestions and comments. Let's talk about, for a moment in our conversation here this morning, about debt sustainability and managing inflation and deflation. In the very uncertain environment for us now, the challenge for fiscal policy is to find the right balance between exploited short-term space to support a fragile recovery and rebuilding longer-term space by advancing fiscal consolidation. In many of the developed nations, debt ratios are at historic highs and rising. Borrowing requirements remain very large. Financial markets continue to be in a state of uncertainty, and downside risks to the global economy exist. Developing countries face particular risks, as many depend on commodities and primary sectors. We do not have convertible currencies, so we are price takers who suffer from the vagaries of the currency exchange movements of our major trading partners. Our productive sectors have been traditionally focused externally, with the result that we are at the mercy of external forces. Fiscal policy has to support and complement other economic and financial measures. The long-term solution to debt management is the achievement of economic growth in our economies and the full employment of all available productive factors of production. I turn now to take a very short look at the Trinidad and Tobago economy, that of my own country. The economy of Trinidad and Tobago has been able to withstand some of the pervasive effects of the global financial crisis and economic downturn because of some of the strong economic buffers and appropriate government action to support macroeconomic activity, including our international reserves at the end of 2011 were US $9.8 billion, up from US $8.7 billion in 2009. This was the equivalent of 13 months of import cover. Secondly, our government of Trinidad and Tobago has been seeking to boost local investment and economic activity and also attract foreign direct investment by ensuring a strong and sound macroeconomic framework and a business-friendly environment. I always say Trinidad and Tobago is open for business. We also go into the fields of investment through transparency and predictability of commodity prices, innovation and enterprise. Our national innovation policy places increased focus on small and micro entrepreneurial activity, given its potential to increase economic growth, employment opportunities, and social development. We have established an innovation fund to allow talented individuals and firms with pioneering business ideas the opportunity to develop their concepts into marketable products. We have also established an economic development board and a council for competitiveness and innovation, mandated to improve global competitiveness and to support an investment strategy for diversification of our economy. Given the importance of information and communication technology, we launched an IT platform to modernize the way companies connect with government agencies in the process of conducting business and trade. This platform, Mr. Chairman, will reduce the processing time for trade-related applications, which will ultimately enhance business competitiveness in Trinidad and Tobago. In respect of human capital development, my government believes this is the most critical success factor for transforming our economy. Our medium-term targets for human capital development include, but not limited to, increasing tertiary education and participation rates to 60% by 2012, expanding and diversifying our secondary school curriculum. Thirdly, realigning curriculum at the tertiary level to support market demand and to create entrepreneurs and innovators. And we are working very feverishly, Mr. Chairman, you may be pleased to know, universal early childhood education by 2015. We have been very fortunate. We have already achieved universal primary education. We have already achieved universal secondary education. And so we look at both ends now, universal childhood education and, of course, at the tertiary sector. To expand that tertiary sector to 60% and, of course, to have universal early childhood education by 2015. Trinidad and Tobago is considered the regional financial center for the Caribbean. We have a very well-developed financial sector, accounting for approximately 25% of non-energy GDP. However, the global financial crisis has exposed our vulnerability to systemic risk and heightened the need for stronger financial regulation and more effective financial sector legislation, including improved corporate governance. And so we look to international standards of regulation. Additionally, my government has been involved in enhancing supervision and strengthening of our local regulatory framework for the financial sector. Our legislative agenda includes upgrading the regulation and supervision of our insurance sector, the securities services and credit unions, and increasing coverage for financial institutions by our Deposit Insurance Corporation. Also high on our agenda is strengthening cooperation among regulators at the national level, the regional level, and indeed at international levels to facilitate the continuous exchange of information and to develop a common approach towards regulation. There's already been progress in this direction with the establishment of a Caribbean group of securities regulators and the offshore group of collective investment schemes supervisors. The CGSR has developed a common takeover code for mergers and acquisitions in addition to choice of law rules. In my own country, Trinidad and Tobago, we have begun a program of regulatory cooperation with the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions in Canada with respect to Canadian banks which operate in our jurisdiction. And we are also establishing a similar arrangement with our neighbors in the Caribbean region. At the recent 2012 meeting of regional and international securities regulators in Buenos Aires, Argentina, my country, Trinidad and Tobago, through the local Securities and Exchange Commission, was elected as the third representative of the Inter-American Regional Committee of the International Organization of Securities Commissions for 2012-2014, Mr. Chair. In this role, we work closely with the newly elected chair and vice chair of the Council of Securities Regulators of the Americas to bring the attention of the board, the interests, needs, and opinions of the region. An important component of regulatory mechanisms is to make them immune from international criminal activity. Consequently, compliance with the anti-money laundering and combating the financing of terrorism guidelines is also an integral part of the financial industry, since these measures minimize the threat of becoming a target for money launderers and financiers of terrorism. Through our National Securities and Exchange Commission, we have issued AML-CFT guidelines to assist actors within the securities industry to ensure that they comply with significant AML-CFT-related legislation passed between 2009 and 2011. These guidelines outline the necessary measures which market actors should undertake to minimize the risk of the securities market being the target of the perpetrators of financial crime. In 2009, my country, Trinidad and Tobago, established for the first time the Financial Intelligence Unit, the FIU, as a very tangible initiative towards minimizing that threat. This unit was established to implement the anti-money laundering policies of the Financial Action Task Force, the FATF. We are also committed to strengthening transparency in the conduct of businesses locally. In 2011, my country became the 102nd member jurisdiction in the OECD's Global Forum on Transparency and Exchange of Information for Tax Purposes. This forum is responsible for the implementation of international standards of transparency and exchange of information by both OECD and non-OECD countries. As we seek to increase the level of investment flows in all sectors of our economy, our participation in this forum is a critical step in facilitating the implementation of these international standards of transparency, of exchange of information, which will intensify the level and quality of engagement with both current and potential partners by way of appropriate investment and taxation treaties. In addition, we are also strengthening our capacity for negotiation of double taxation agreements. This will facilitate removal of tax barriers to cross-border trade and investment by providing for the elimination of double taxation, certainty of tax treatment, a reduction of tax rates, the prevention of fiscal evasion, and the prevention of tax discrimination, as well as the resolution of tax disputes. In an effort to keep abreast with global standards, my country recently participated in the World Bank's report on the Observance of Standards and Codes Initiative. This is aimed at benchmarking this country's corporate governance framework and company practices, against the OECD principles for corporate governance, developing and implementing a country action plan for improving international and institutional capacity with a view to strengthening my country's corporate governance framework and raising awareness of good corporate governance practices within the public and private sector stakeholders. Mr. Chairman, I share the view that while young people are innocent bystanders in the global financial crisis, they may end up paying the heaviest price as they will be called upon to work longer to service the debts accumulated in recent years and to support an increasingly aging population. Moreover, our young people face high levels of unemployment. Our young people between the ages of 15 to 24 are the most affected. Youth employment has climbed to record levels in a number of countries. In the Caribbean, we are facing a crisis in particular with male youths who are at risk and are drawn to the scourge of the illegal drug trade and to gang activity. These youths appear to have been locked out of the modern economy as a result of them not properly accessing the required skills and training via the various educational systems. This stark reality requires, in my respectful view, aggressive and sustained action from us if we as leaders are to ensure that the legacy of stolen dreams is reversed by restoring hope and opportunity across the length and breadth of the global economy. Mr. Chairman, as I close, I say there is a significant amount of work to do. The goal of my government, that of Trinidad and Tobago, is to build an economy which is capable of generating endogenous growth, based on knowledge generation and innovation, increase productivity levels, and export expansion in order to create wider opportunities for high-paying jobs at all levels. The eradication of poverty and the conditions which create and sustain poverty has become one of the top priorities of my government. Specifically, our poverty-focused policies comprise a number of initiatives, including the Regional Micro Project Fund, the Micro Enterprise Training and Development Grant, and the Micro Enterprise Loan, all of which are designed to impact the incidence of poverty throughout various communities in my country, Trinidad and Tobago. We also intend to reform our social safety net by establishing a comprehensive social security system targeting the most vulnerable, women, the elderly, children, and the differently able, as well as by assisting households to take hold of opportunities which create prosperity and reduce the number of people classified as poor by 2% each year. My government's total policy framework is focused on delivering strong economic growth, more comprehensive and better targeted social programs, including strengthening social protection for greater inclusiveness, and more important, to improve access to education. Mr. Chairman, in conclusion, I say, I am confident that based on the reforms being undertaken in my country, Trinidad and Tobago, we are in a position to play our part in addressing the effects of the world financial and economic crisis. However, we recognize that the problems created by this crisis require action from all our partners in the national community. Without concerted efforts aimed at creating a sense of commonality, we will not be in a position to combat unemployment, to increase stability and transparency in the financial sector, or to create an environment for increasing production, trade, and investment. In my respectful view, Mr. Chairman, the UN has a central role to play in this transformation. In my own country, we celebrate this year 50 years of membership of this organization, the United Nations, whilst at the same time, we celebrate 50 years of independence from our colonial masters. My country, Trinidad and Tobago, remains committed to continue to work with the UN and other multilateral agencies to bring about the desired changes in the international economic and financial architecture. Mr. Chairman, I thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
I thank the Prime Minister of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago for her statement. I now give the floor of His Excellency Wuna Mangluin, the Union Minister of Foreign Affairs of Myanmar.
Mr. Chairman, Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, allow me to express my appreciation for convening this very important high-level thematic debate. I wish to congratulate the President of the General Assembly and the Secretary General of the United Nations for co-chairing the HLTG. It is high time for the international community to cope with the world economic and financial crisis with a stronger global effort. We are of the view that this important gathering gave us an opportunity to relieve the burden of debt crisis and poverty across the world. We also recognize that the United Nations play a vital role to find a common solution in universal economic and social cooperation. Myanmar believes that international cooperation among the UN, leading economies, and regional and international organizations strengthens multilateral approach to manage global economic challenges. Mr. Chairman, in order to combat unemployment, Myanmar government has been trying to build more industries and to attract foreign direct investment by creating a favorable environment. Myanmar eases many financial restraints and amends and revises investment laws and regulations. Furthermore, the government is finding ways and means to support small and medium enterprises which not only create more jobs, especially for the women and youth, but also help achieve stable economic growth. Addressing poverty and social protection, our government is giving high priority to poverty alleviation and rural development. Our target is to reduce the poverty rate from 26% at present to 16% in 2015. Dumai has been undertaking many far-reaching reform measures since the new government took office. Many governments have now lifted or suspended sanctions and restrictions imposed against Myanmar in recognition and support of our reform process. We appreciate their actions, which will contribute to facilitating economic reforms, creating jobs, and generating income for the people. However, there remain some restrictions which could still hamper investors' confidence and affect the flow of foreign direct investments and business activities. Therefore, we call upon all countries concerned to remove all restrictions as soon as possible. Excuse me. Mr. Chairman, while creating an environment to increase production, trade and investment, the multilateral trading system should be fair, rational, equitable and universal. It is vested with the responsibility to coordinate the trade policies, maintain international trade relations, reduce trade frictions and promote world economic growth. The developed and developing countries should fulfill their commitments, firmly stand against protectionism in all manifestations, and continue to push forward the Doha round of negotiations. At the same time, the principle of openness, inclusiveness, and transparency should be upheld in pursuing regional and sub-regional economic cooperation and establishing free trade areas. It is essential that financing provides security for people saving and mobilizing resources for productive investment. With public financing still at the center of international development assistance, developed countries should honor their ODA commitments and step up assistance for the least developed countries to meet the targets of the Istanbul Action Plan. Maintaining the appropriate offshore development assistance levels is crucial for the economic development of the developing countries. In conclusion, I would like to call upon all countries, developed or developing, to collaborate and cooperate closely to face the increasingly complex and integrated global economic and financial challenges. I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the Union Minister of Foreign Affairs of Myanmar. Now I will address the floor with some remarks of mine representing Lebanon and the MENA region. The profound political transformations that are currently taking place in the MENA region deserve the full support of the international community with the aim of strengthening political and economical governance across the different countries of the region. The historical change observed in the Arab country presents tremendous opportunity for democracy, economic growth, investment, and widespread development, including aspiration for political reform and social justice. Democracy and growth can provide a solid foundation of stability and ensure sustainable development in the MENA region, along with interrelational improvement with other areas of the world following decades of tensions. Given the significant